The Olympic Games 2012 for me is going to be a chance to see the greatest spectacle on earth come to my hometown.
I think it's going to be really, really good for London.
Olympic Games 2012, totally pumped.
This will be the third time we've had it in London.
I am proud that London will organise the Olympic tour.
And we'll attract more young people to come in London.
It's going to bring a lot of tourism.
London, London!
And therefore trade, and therefore money and people and vibes.
Yay! I have a little six-year-old boy, and I'm really hoping it will inspire him to get more active, get more into sports.
Actually, I came all the way from Canada just to see the Olympic Games.
I think there's going to be a really nice atmosphere and just bringing people together, which will be really nice.
Hey.
Ja, ik ook. Mocht je de afgelopen maanden onder een steen geleefd hebben, dan weet je dit niet. Maar 2012, dat is Olympische Spelen.
Voilà, we zijn er. Londen, de eerste stad ter wereld die de Olympische Spelen voor een derde keer mag organiseren. Dus we zijn er niet een klein beetje trots. De komende weken trek ik trouwens door de stad om u te bewijzen dat ze nog altijd een klein beetje voor is op de rest. Mr. Cab Driver, what's your name? My name's Ben.
Hi Ben, I'm Rob. Welcome to London.
Thank you. You're my friend of the day. Ik ben een taxi ingestapt die je niet zomaar van A naar B brengt, maar waarbij de taxichauffeur je ook nog eens uitleg geeft bij de plekken die je aandoet.
If you want a panoramic tour of London, and you want to see all the historical sites, then why not do it in an iconic London black cab?
Black cab. Black cab.
Take to be a London cab driver?
You've got to spend up to 3 years on the knowledge. The knowledge of London, as it's called. I did my knowledge some 27 years ago.
That's what you call it, the knowledge of London.
The knowledge of London. You get to learn something like 18,000 streets.
18,000?
Yeah, you need to go to evening classes. You've got to get out on a moped, learn the streets of London, on all the places of interest. On those streets.
Incredible. So if anybody knows the city, it's got to be you. So what are we seeing today?
Today, first stop, we're off to the Tower of London. A lot of monarchs have lost their heads in the Tower of London, and up on Tower Hill, a lot of people have been executed. And let me tell you, public executions in days of old were very, very popular. Thousands of people used to come to public executions, much in the same way that they go to Premier League football matches these days.
Oh.
A lot of people have lost their heads in the Tower of London, but don't worry, Ben, yours will be still on your neck by the time we finish the tour.
Geweldig. Ik mocht dan een taxichauffeur kiezen en ik koos er een met een gevoel voor humor.
De oudste gevangenis van het land is het, de Tower. Vandaag wordt er niet meer onthoofd, maar ze wordt wel nog bewaakt.
Good morning.
Hello,
konnichiwa. From Japan?
Japan.
Oh, terrific. Where are we now? This is the Tower of London?
Yes.
I'm looking for the name of the person who guards the tower. The guard of the tower. What are they called?
I know William of Kilnkirker.
John?
Paul?
Ik ben een naam kwijt.
Nee.
Oh ja. Ik heb dat vorige week bezocht. Oké, I see. London Ta Shou Wei. Ja.
Flush is dat.
What the beef is.
Why are they called beef eaters?
I don't know. Is it because they've been in a war?
Where the war, the French had took their beef or something.
I guess they enjoyed beef.
And they have this kind of like big fluffy black hat on top.
De pantaloni bombati sotto.
Een zwart uniform met rood.
Rode letters en ER erop.
I'm Jan Water Kevin Kitcher.
I'm one of the 37 yeoman warders at the Tower of London.
Ja, en de beef-eaters die werden al aangesteld sinds de 12e eeuw hier in de Tower of London, toen het voor mannen nog oké was om minirokjes te dragen. Good morning, Kevin.
Good morning, Ben.
Hallo. So you're a beef-eater.
That is a nickname that's given to us. This nickname came around about 800 years ago. The reason for it has been lost in time. The official reasons for it, you'd have thought they'd have written it down with all the history that's going around here, but they didn't. It's just been lost in time.
But you guys have a very special function right here at the Tower of London because you're the guards.
We do guard the tower. We guard the tower to make sure it's safe and secure. All the beef eaters all come from the ranks of the armed forces. You must have served a minimum of 22 years in the armed forces themselves.
So you're a real... You used to be a real soldier and...
Yes, that's right.
Okay. I quite fancy your uniform that you're wearing right now. It does have a sort of meaning, doesn't it?
On the front, you'll see the royal cipher, E2R. Yes. The R, that stands for Regina, the Latin word for is queen. Elizabeth II is queen. Of course, each monarch since 1660 has had their own royal cipher.
And these special ribbons, what do they mean?
These are personal. These are ribbons that for campaign service in the armed forces.
Okay, okay. What does it make you feel like wearing this?
Proud.
Alleen echte mannen kunnen trots zijn, zelfs al dragen ze een jurkje. Maar beef eaters hebben alle recht om trots te zijn, want zij bewaken vandaag stukken als The Imperial Crown of India and the Great Star of Africa.
So, to make one thing clear, you're not a tourist attraction.
We are guards here at the tower. However, the visitors do see us as a tourist attraction. If they do come and ask up for a photograph, please ask, and we're more than happy to let them have what they want.
Yeah, but do you get any funny situations then?
The questions that people come here with. Yeah, some of them we've got a little book for, which we've been running since 1992. And the most bizarre question been asked, of course, is which tower was Rapunzel held in?
I was wondering as well. I mean, which tower was it?
The same one as Sleeping Beauty, the big one in the middle.
Did you know that London was very heavily bombed during the Second World War?
Yes, Rob, I knew that, but didn't they tell you not to mention the war?
Well, a lot of homes and properties were destroyed, of course, and one of the wings of Buckingham Palace received a direct hit. And the Queen Mother was actually quite pleased about that, in a way.
She was pleased?
She was pleased because she said, because we're now bombed, I can now look other Londoners in the eye.
Okay.
And at the time, of course, during the Second World War, especially in this part of Westminster, there was many underground bunkers. And we're going off to one now, Ben. We're going to the Cabinet War Room.
Thanks, Rob.
Cheers, Ben.
Tot 1983 was bijna niemand op de hoogte van deze plek. Slechts een aantal ingewijden. En dat maakt het wel speciaal dat je hier vandaag mag rondlopen. De Cabinet War Rooms, recentelijk omgedoopt tot de Winston Churchill War Rooms. Omdat ja, de grootste Brit aller tijden, Winston Churchill, nu eenmaal meer volk lokt. Het is een gigantische ondergrondse bunker waar de top van het Britse leger tijdens Wereldoorlog 2 de belangrijkste beslissingen nam. Je zou dus kunnen zeggen dat deze plek op een bepaald moment het epicentrum, de brain center van de wereld was. Sommige medewerkers die verbleven hier maanden aan een stuk zonder ook maar één straaltje zonlicht op te vangen. Winston Churchill zelf die verbleef hier vrijwel nooit. Hij bleef hier wel geteld 3 keer slapen, omdat het volgens hem niet luxueus genoeg was.
We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island.
Hier in het Churchill Museum wordt het leven van de man van naaldje tot draadje uitgelegd. Je vindt er trouwens ook de grootste verzameling van zo'n straffe uitspraken, want hij had er heel wat. En een van mijn favoriete uitspraken moet wel geweest zijn: History will be kind to me, for I intend to write it myself.
We're going off to see Big Ben now. I know your Big Ben, but we're going off to see our Big Ben.
The other Big Ben.
The other Big Ben, yeah. During World War II, Londoners and British people, they felt assured when they heard the chimes of Big Ben on the news reports, because they kind of thought that the government was still in London and hadn't run off to the safety of the countryside.
So they didn't know it was just a tape running.
They didn't know it was just a tape, Ben. So, Big Ben is not the name of the clock tower, by the way. Big Ben is the bell, which was cast in the Whitechapel Foundry in 1858.
Just following you.
So that's the moulding gauge on the wall there, the large one that we used for making the mould for Big Ben.
So when was this? When was it cast?
It was cast in 1858.
Yeah.
It was actually the second bell.
Okay.
The first bell was cast in the north of England, and whilst it was being tested, it broke up. So the client then came here, and so bell number two was made here, and it's bell number two, of course, which you hear.
And it hasn't broken until today.
Until today, it hasn't broken. The bell actually is cracked.
It is.
When it was first hung, the hammer was more than twice the size that was recommended by this foundry. The hammer size was then reduced, and the bell has continued to chime ever since without the crack extending any further.
Okay, but it altered the sound, because the sound is what you British people are talking about every time. The sound of Big Ben is one of the most...
Absolutely. Well, I think it's fair to assume that the sound did change. The problem is there is no one alive today who would have heard the sound before 1859. So I guess it changed, but we don't know how much it changed. We have no record of that.
13.760 kilogram. Zoveel weegt Big Ben, of the Great Bell of Westminster, zoals ze officieel heet.
Sorry.
Ja, om zo'n werk tot een goed einde te brengen, daar heb je vakmannen voor nodig.
So that's my great grandfather up there, Mr. A. Hughes, died August 2nd, 1916. He started work here in 1884 as general manager.
Uh-huh.
Then in 1904, he purchased the business.
So you're the fourth generation?
Fourth generation of the Hughes family.
Of the Hughes family.
From a very young age, I used to travel around with my father, doing site surveys, looking at bells in various churches up and down the country. And I, you know, went through school like everybody else, but when I came through school, it didn't occur to me that I'd be doing anything else. I never really thought about it. I just kind of started working here, and I'm still working here.
It's not just about the tower bells these days?
No, we make small bells, mainly musical hand bells, but clock bells, small presentation bells, a whole range of small bells.
Okay.
And this is where we tune them, in our tuning room here.
Good day, gentlemen.
Hello.
Hello there.
The process is repetitive in that we're pitching and then we're cutting, we're pitching and then we're cutting. And each time the bell is cut, the bell moves closer and closer to the final required pitch. Every job that we do is unique. I have been crawling around on the roof of Buckingham Palace inspecting bells. I have also met the Queen. So we get to meet a whole range of people. And that's part of the interest of the work. No two jobs are the same, and you meet a whole range of people.
Mm-hmm. You know, my name's Ben. Would you have a small Big Ben, maybe?
Well, that's Little Ben, presumably.
Little Ben, yes, yes.
This is it, a small, exact replica of the real Big Ben.
Wow, incredible. Alsjeblieft, ik heb hem eindelijk. Mijn eigen klokkenspel. Thank you so much, Helen. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
8 miljoen mensen, 270 nationaliteiten. Het is hier een zeer kleurrijk boeltje. London by Tata. En rond Piccadilly Circus je ogen uitkijken, dat is ook al een attractie op zich.
Apparently this is the best place to have coffee in London. That's what he said.
Yeah, what I tell you?
This is very good. It's lekker. It's geweldig eigenlijk. Now this is an insider's tip you get there, right?
Minder insider, meer outsider is Camden Market. De shops zijn meestal bric-à-brac. De kledij die je hier vindt is van een dubieuze kwaliteit.
Camden Market. In de jaren 70 was dit het Walhalla van de rockabillies en de punkrockers. Ja, zoals je ziet wordt het vandaag overspoeld door toeristen. De meeste toeristen denken dat de Camden Market enkel dit hier is, maar eigenlijk moet je een van de steegjes links induiken.
Ga bijvoorbeeld naar de Historic Stables Market.
Rock on, mate.
Want het gezellige laid-back sfeertje dat je hier nog vindt, herinnert er des te meer aan hoe het was in den beginnen, toen Camden nog alternatief was.
You were there.
Yeah.
In the beginning?
I'll be here 25 years, so basically the beginning, yeah.
What was it like?
Rough.
Why?
Well, because all the ground would be rough. I mean, there was nobody sweeping up. It was alternative to the inn. People came for the ripped jeans, you know, which nobody else was wearing, for the weird gear and the old Beatles coats and the Afghan coats. They come here. You didn't follow fashion in Camden, you made it. So you've got the John Courtiers, your stylish people. You didn't even know they'd come in looking scruffy.
Did you ever see Jean Paul Gaultier right
here?
Oh,
absolutely.
What'd he do?
Yeah, he would look around. If he saw a style, he would buy it and or copy it or get inspiration.
It came from here?
Exactly.
Okay, now what I get is these days, everything has changed. They've stripped the building. It's like a Disney version of what it used to be right now. Everything's safe and everything.
An American version.
Why should I come here?
Because it's a good day out, you don't have to spend anything. There's still that edge here, you know, which will always sort of be here. The fact that the people that run this market now are a bit crazy anyway, it actually helps. You know what I mean? They've done nutty things and it all helps.
Okay. Any vintage, nice vintage stuff you...
If you came here during the week, you can find little pockets downstairs or various stores that would have stuff, you know, but it's best any buyers come during the week.
All right.
When it's quiet and they can talk and people know what they want and what they're looking for.
Well, Brian, it's been an honour
talking
to you. The oldest man in Stables Market.
Exactly.
Thanks a lot. London traffic, setting the future. London traffic, blocking the streets. London traffic, going nowhere. This is the south bank of the Thames, Ben, where Shakespeare's Globe is. The south bank of the Thames in those days was a den of iniquity, full of thieves, vagabonds and prostitutes.
Oh, that's a picture.
Thankfully, these days, it's a wonderful place for tourists to come and visit, and I hope you have a good time.
Very well.
Eerlijk gezegd, hier kijk ik nu eens echt naar uit. De Shakespeare Globe, daar wandel je gewoon de geschiedenis binnen.
Ho, ho, ho. Now this is the real thing. But yes,
in a way. It's as close to the real thing as we could have made it.
It's an exact copy.
Very much, yeah. Pretty much.
What happened to the original then?
The original Glow back in 1599 was very, very successful, but in 1613 there was an accident with a cannon, and it was probably unwise to use a cannon in a wooden theatre with a
thatch roof. Of roof like that, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So when the cannon was fired, something from the cannon landed on the thatch, and the entire theatre burnt to the ground in 2 hours.
Okay, and then there was somebody who came up with the idea, why don't we build a Globe Theatre all over again?
Yeah, yeah. He was Sam Wanamaker. He was an American actor and director who came across from Chicago in 1949. And whilst he was in London, he tried to discover some sort of monument to Shakespeare, but we had nothing.
Nobody came up with the idea before him.
No. So Sam dedicated the rest of his life to raising the money to build this theatre. And he started by phoning everyone in London whose surname was Shakespeare and asking them for £300. Just out of the blues. They had no idea who he was. So, hello, I'm Sam. Can I have £300? And they did.
So they offered him money.
They just gave him money. It's brilliant. And none of them are related to William Shakespeare at all.
The site is absolutely beautiful. Let me picture this. It's the 17th century. Yep. Shakespeare just wrote a play. And we're here. Yep. What would it be like?
It'd be busy. It'd be crammed. There are about 3,000 people at the theatre. So it'd be 1,000 people standing here called penny stinkards because they pay one penny.
And they stink.
And they stink. They smell incredibly bad. And then all of this would be full of merchants and tradesmen and that sort of thing. Yeah. Everyone facing the stage.
Well, since we're here, might as well get on stage then.
Do some...
I don't know. I remember a few lines from a play I saw once called Julius Caesar. Well, so this is what it's like. You know microphones, you just... Oh, my God, the acoustics. They're incredible. You get to participate in this. Is that it? Or just in the end? You get
just at the end.
Applaud or...
Oh, we wouldn't necessarily applaud. So if we liked it, we'll stamp our feet. Doesn't make that much noise these days.
So Marcus Aurelius would go like, friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. I've come to bury Caesar, not to praise him. For the bad of people often lives after them. The good is oft interred with their bones. So it will be with Julius Caesar.
Oké, Broadway is misschien nog niet voor morgen, maar theoretisch gezien heb ik nu wel op het podium van een internationaal theater gestaan. Hoera!
So, it's like 4:30. Getting kind of hungry, so it might be time for my afternoon tea right now.
Langham Hotel, Ben. For the perfect afternoon tea in London. Here we are.
Well, Rob, I must say it was an absolute pleasure having this time with you. And if I ever come back to London, I'll be sure to...
Enjoy your company, Ben.
Yeah.
See you again.
Okay, thanks so much, man.
Bye now.
Bye-bye. Bet you think that's pretty
clever, don't you, boy? The Langham. De plek waar afternoon tea tot kunst verheven werd. Ik kan er maar beter een beetje deftig bij lopen.
Stephen, this is a very special moment for me because this is actually the first time that I'll be having afternoon tea.
Well, fantastic. You've got to start somewhere.
Exactly. And I get to have it with Mr. Twining himself. Incredible.
Delighted you could join me.
Where did this come from, this afternoon tea drinking?
The whole afternoon tea thing starts in the 1830s. A senior lady in waiting to the court of Queen Victoria, 7th Duchess of Bedford, looking after the Queen, busy working lady. Lunch was at noon, dinner was at 8 o'clock in the evening, and there was nothing in between. And at 4 o'clock, she felt her energy levels going down and needed something to refresh her and to revive her. Very sensibly chose to drink tea, because tea is one of the world's naturally most refreshing drinks, and took light, delicate food to carry her into the evening, but without spoiling her appetite for dinner. And so English afternoon tea was created.
Brilliant. Okay.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Well, yes, I'm supposed to have some tea.
Most certainly you are. What sort of tea do you like?
What do you suggest?
The most important thing about tea drinking is you choose the cup of tea that pleases you, and you drink it the way you like it.
I think I'll go for the Silver Needle Yellow Tea, the favourite of Chairman Mao.
I think I'll go for that one then.
Excellent choice.
What are you having?
I'm going to have a Darjeeling, please. Thank you.
Darjeeling?
Yes.
I love these names as well. I mean, so what you have with this tea are, of course, your
scones. But actually, what we would do to start with, we would help ourselves to the savouries, so the delicate sandwiches. When we've had enough of those, we would move on to the scones, which are served with a special cream called clotted cream. Very indulgent, very rich.
But it's tougher on the stomach, maybe.
No. It's fantastic. It's okay. Just fantastic. And you've got to experience it. Yeah. And then we'd end with the really small, delicate sweets. And that is, if you like, the classic English afternoon tea.
Stephen, you are the 10th generation of the Twinings family.
Thank you.
Twinings family in tea business.
Yes.
That's incredible.
It is. I mean, very little to do with me. I was just lucky enough to be born as the 10th generation and found what the previous generations had found, and that is a passion for this fantastic gift of nature.
How did it all start off? Mr. Twinings.
Mr. Thomas Twining, who had done an apprenticeship with an East India merchant who imported tea, and then at the age of 31, he wanted to start his own business. At the time, there was over 2,000 coffee houses in the city of London. So to make something different about his coffee house, he sold tea and opened the world's first dry tea and coffee shop.
Wow.
And yes, I think possibly the greatest gift he gave us was the philosophy. He wanted his reputation to be for doing one thing and one thing really well, and that was buying and blending fine quality teas.
Yes.
That is a timeless philosophy.
That's what you're known for, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
Now I'm going to taste my tea. Yeah. Should I put up my pinky like that?
The way you drink it, that's your choice.
I add the style.
You
to
add the style, absolutely.
Okay. I'll add the style then with a pinky. Might even start talking like a true Englishman afterwards.
I thought you already were.
Alsjeblieft. Voilà. 135 meter hoogte. Londen ligt eindelijk aan mijn voeten. En ik mag nu met recht en reden zeggen dat wij op het Europese vasteland niks hebben dat ook maar een klein beetje te vergelijken valt met deze wereldstad. Het is absoluut een eiland op een eiland. En ik heb trouwens nog een gouden tip, want je kan deze capsules van de London Eye afhuren voor jou en je vrienden voor een feestje om eventueel samen eens eventjes uit de bol te gaan. En dat gaan we nu ook doen. Champagne. Strawberries. Dankjewel. Dat noemen ze dan een receptie op niveau. Trouwens, volgende week pakken we het een klein beetje anders aan. Want dan gaan we volledig voor de budgettips in Londen. Gezondheid.
Dit was hem. De Londense klassiekers allemaal op een rij. Met de Eurostar ben je er in minder dan 2 uur. Adressen vind je op onze website 1.be/Vlaanderen Vakantieland.